The Legend of Zelda is my favourite video game series of all time, but that won't stop me from unfairly nitpicking design choices made in response to the technical limitations of computer hardware as well as the human brain. I'm talking about their control schemes. The controller has been a staple of video games ever since the first pieces of hardware specialised for running games. For the majority of the time computers have existed for, controlling them via telepathy has not been possible, so the designers have had to settle for creating specialised hardware that provides an interface with which the user can interact with the computer. For video game systems, the designers tried all sorts of arrangements and gimmicks before deciding around the 6th generation of consoles that the best controllers usually included some face buttons, bumpers, triggers, analog sticks, and a directional pad. The Legend of Zelda, being a long-running series dating back to the 3rd generation of consoles, serves as a good reference point to look at the evolution of controllers. Being exclusive to Nintendo systems, it benefits from Nintendo's generally solid controller design, assuming the game designers know what they're doing with it. Now I, a lowly youth with no commercially released video games under my name, would not like to accuse these professional game designers of not knowing what they're doing, but there are some control decisions in these games that I would at least like to inquire them on their design philosophy behind. To be fair, a lot of the control decisions in this series do make sense, and we can infer their design philosophies ourselves simply by looking at them. The 2D games are a good starting place for this due to their simplicity. Almost every Nintendo controller has a D-pad that can be pressed in 8 directions across 2 axes, perfect for moving a character from a top-down perspective. From here, the functions of the buttons are decided based on the core actions of the game, and the core actions of the game are decided based on the available buttons. These two factors are integral to each other. When developing for a single platform, the limitations of that platform, including its controllers, are a heavy influence on game design. But even with all the gizmos modern controllers have, some games opt to limit the buttons used so as to stay simple for the average player. You don't want casuals repeatedly dying because they forgot which button does which in a demanding situation. Ever since the first Zelda game on the NES, the core ideas of the series have been exploration, item collecting, and sword fighting. So the design has allocated one button to swinging the sword, another button to using a collected item, and a pause menu to changing the item that said button uses. Future games on consoles with more buttons took the opportunity to add dedicated interact buttons or shield buttons, but these two buttons have remained a constant in every game except the awkward NES sequel side-scroller. One of those buttons, the item button, is the source of my first issue with the controls in many games across this series. There aren't enough of them. Most Zelda games have too many items to assign each one to its own button, and even if this was possible, it'd be hard to remember what each item is assigned to. Instead, the games keep it down to 1, 2, 3, or on occasion 4 item buttons, and allow the player to swap out the items on each button via dedicated menu. This approach works fine for Zelda, a series with a rather slow pace and a lot of puzzle solving. The number of item buttons in each game is also dependent on the number of buttons on the controller, so I can't blame some games for not having many item buttons. However, I can't help but look at a lot of them and think they aren't using the controller optimally. I see a lot of unused or redundant buttons and think these could have been extra item buttons instead. Zelda 1 has Select pause the game, but Start already does that, so Select could have cycled through each of the 10 items. A Link to the Past has L and R do nothing, when these could have been item buttons or cycled through each item, just something. The Minish Cap has L bring up the Kinstone Fusion menu when next to a thought bubble and do nothing otherwise. Select already talks to Eslo, so it could have also prompted Kinstone Fusion and L could have been another item button. A Link Between Worlds starts with one item button, but later gives the player another one via a piece of equipment, and I have to ask, why weren't there two item buttons to begin with? Ocarina of Time has 3 item buttons, but requires pausing the game to swap boots and has 2 entire dungeons dedicated to exactly that when the boots could have been C button items. Granted, this would take up an item button, but it's still better than pausing repeatedly to take the boots on or off. The Wind Waker also has 3 item buttons, only for Twilight Princess to take one of them away to allocate to Talking to Midna, which could have been assigned to a D-pad direction. Tears of the Kingdom doesn't have items in the traditional Zelda sense. Instead, it spreads functions across a variety of melee weapons, shields, bows, materials, ancient powers, and sage abilities. When implementing the latter, the designers must have run into the issue that every single button shared by the game's supported controllers was already taken up by other functions. Therefore, they assigned sage abilities to walking up to the sage in question and pressing A. This is a lot easier said than done when the sages are constantly running around on their own in combat, and a lot easier done than said when the sages are standing still and you're trying to interact with something outside of combat. It's pretty much the worst of both worlds, but again, there weren't any remaining buttons for them to assign these to. From experience, aside from the last example, none of these are deal breakers in practice. They're just weird when you think about them. I guarantee there's a lot to think about when creating a Zelda game, though. Especially when having to contend with times of change in the game's landscape, such as the transition to 3D. This was a time period that required many games to rethink how they played and controlled, and consequently required controlling manufacturers to accommodate new input devices in order to facilitate this. Nintendo's first attempt at this, the Nintendo 64 controller, is a grab bag of ideas, some of which stuck for future controllers and some of which didn't. To assist with 3D games, the center prong features an analog stick to let the player move in any direction along the X and Z axes. This proved to be an invaluable tool for navigating in a 3D space, because cameras had to be more complex too. Earlier 2D game cameras tended to be positioned either side-on or top-down and never changed their angle, which simplified navigation because you could hold one direction in any situation and be guaranteed to move in the same direction each time. 3D games, in order to utilize the advantages of being in 3D, opted to position their cameras either behind the player character or in some other location relative to the player character, and have them follow the player and change their angle accordingly. With this approach, holding one direction would move the player in that direction relative to the camera angle, but said camera could be angled in any direction. Therefore, there's more of a demand to move in a straight line in any direction instead of only 8. The N64 controller has 4 C buttons seemingly intended for camera control, but Zelda Ocarina of Time doesn't use them for that purpose. Instead, 3 of them are used as item buttons, and camera control is allocated to the Z trigger. Tapping it normally centers the camera in Link's direction, whereas pressing or holding it near an object, enemy, or NPC that Navi flies to locks the camera onto them. This is the Z targeting system, and it would not be an exaggeration to say that this revolutionized cameras in 3D games. Countless games of the 5th and 6th console generations are notorious for their uncooperative cameras, and while games had experimented with locking the camera onto one object before, none did so as conveniently as holding down a dedicated trigger. This simplifies control so much and shifts the focus onto navigating and fighting around Link's enemies. Speaking of fighting, the sword is another mechanic that had to be reworked for the third dimension. On a 2D plane, sword fighting is as simple as pressing the button to swing in Link's direction. The developers experimented with diagonal sword swings when developing Link to the Past, but according to series creator Shigeru Miyamoto, this didn't feel very good, so they instead came up with the spin attack, performable by holding then releasing the sword button. In 3D, there's a whole other plane to worry about, and a horizontal swing might miss short objects, which would necessitate a vertical swing. Ocarina of Time sticks to one sword button, but changes the attack used based on the control stick's direction and whether Link is Z-targeting or not. I do think it's a bit overly complicated that the vertical swing requires either holding forward or Z-targeting, while the horizontal swing requires either standing still or holding sideways while Z-targeting, and usually stick to the thrust performed by holding forward while Z-targeting. In a similar fashion, the A button performs a selection of evasive maneuvers as well as the high-risk, high-reward jump slash, all of which I make great use of. However, despite the role being described as a combat ability, it's generally too inconvenient and unnecessary to use in combat. Instead, it's best to spam it to move around faster, but this gets quite grating and mind-numbing over time. For as many nitpicks as I have of these controls, it did a lot right, hence why it was used in the next 3 3D Zelda games. Due to differences in the N64 and GameCube controllers' designs, the Wind Waker rearranged some control bindings. Namely, L now targets, and X, Y, and Z are the 3 item buttons. The C-stick enables free camera control in supported areas, which is nice to have, but overall unnecessary as L targeting is still that good. This brings us to Twilight Princess. The GameCube version follows a similar control scheme to the Wind Waker, but the Wii version had to rethink some controls because... Well, look at the Wii Remote next to the GameCube controller. They're barely comparable. One glance at the Wii Remote should tell you that this console was nothing like its predecessors. This was a console of new possibility, where moving the remote around would perform actions, allowing for new experiences in games that simply couldn't be achieved on other hardware. So, how exactly does a GameCube game get ported to it? They could have retained the option to connect a GameCube controller. Did you think this GameCube port would let you use your measly GameCube controllers? No! We've got a Wii Remote to demo! This game requires the nunchuck, adding an analog stick and two shoulder buttons to the Wii remote, thus allowing for some familiarity with the control stick moving Link, Z targeting, and A interacting. The most noticeable difference is that swinging the sword and holding the shield up lack their own buttons, because they're instead tied to motion controls. Shaking the Wii remote swings the sword, shaking the nunchuck does the spin attack, and thrusting the nunchuck forward holds the shield. This isn't the best utilization of the Wii's motion controls, as the direction the Wii remote is swung in doesn't affect the sword attack Link uses, only the control stick's direction and whether Link is Z-targeting or not do so, as if swinging the remote is only replicating pressing B. If the player swings the Wii remote down, Link could instead swing it horizontally or thrust it forward, effectively destroying the illusion of the player's movements determining in-game inputs that was the whole appeal of the Wii. Since this is a port from the GameCube, it makes sense why it's replicating a simple button press. I just think they should have reworked the sword controls if possible, which I believe it would have been looking at the other motion controls littered about the game. For example, using the fishing rod requires holding the Wii remote vertically and the nunchuck sideways, then rotating the latter like you're reeling a fish in. As a child, this got me stuck in the starting area for years because I couldn't figure this out until I found it in the manual. Historically, I've not been good at practical problem solving. But wait, if Link is traditionally left-handed and most players are right-handed, wouldn't it feel weird to swing the sword in the opposite hand? Series producer Eiji Aonuma noticed this during development, and the solution the game ended up taking was to make Link right-handed mirror the entire game for the Wii version, in a move equivalent to Aonuma bringing out a bulldozer to move a pebble off his front doorstep. It's hilarious how unnecessary and extreme the solution is, until you find yourself switching versions and everything you remember has to be adjusted now. This doesn't even accommodate the left-handed gamers who do exist. Lucky for us, then came Skyward Sword to double down on these motion controls using the power of Wii Motion Plus. Now Wii remote movements directly correspond to Link's sword movements, and there are several fights centered around hitting the enemy in the right place. Functionally, Link is still always right-handed. Or is the game still mirrored and we simply don't have a reference point? After all, Skyward Sword Link in Mario Kart 8 is left-handed. I think with this game, some people started to complain that the motion controls were too much, but I have never played Skyward Sword, so I can't give an informed opinion on this matter. However, one instance of motion control in both of these games that I believe is genuinely fantastic is the IR aiming. Certain items, such as the bow, are aimed with the Wii remote's pointer, which is so much more precise and convenient than aiming with an analog stick. Rather than holding an analog stick direction, waiting, then possibly repositioning, you just need to point in the right direction. This is the exact type of intuitive motion control that helped the Wii succeed, so no wonder this idea has stayed around when many of the Wii's other motion controls have been left behind in that era. Future Nintendo platforms all incorporate gyroscopes that many of their Zelda games, including remakes, use to replicate this motion aiming. And although it isn't as precise as infrared and needs recalibration, it works great regardless and is splendid to have on a traditional controller. Nintendo's other massive innovation of this era was the DS's touchscreen, and it had a similar philosophy to the Wii remote. Let players input by doing motions similar to real-life tasks they already know in order to boost casual appeal and approachability. This benefited all sorts of casual games and applications, but what could it do for Zelda? Nintendo asked themselves this question, looked at the DS, then said everything. Everything in Phantom Hourglass and Spirit Tracks, from movement to combat to items, is controlled using the touchscreen. The D-pad and buttons are only here as hotkeys to bring up menus. Heck, the inevitability that players would complain about this is even lampshaded in-game. They were committed to this control scheme. Now, call me one of those aforementioned players, but I'm not feeling these controls. There's too much going on a singular input device and too much overlap between actions. Good touchscreen implementations in games are ones whose very concepts feel tailor-made for such a device. For example, write numbers to solve maths exercises or draw lines to guide a character through a stage. These two games are just traditional top-down Zelda games, which previously required multiple buttons for all the actions, only with all the actions crammed onto the touchscreen. As a result, it feels cramped and prone to misinputs, and not like many of these actions benefit from being on the touchscreen. Whenever I go for the horizontal slice, I just end up walking forward a few steps and making a fool of myself in front of these actors in a video game. It's humiliating, and at no point in that process did I feel like I was swinging a sword. In the end, though, the actions of many speak louder than the words of one, and Phantom Hourglass supposedly sold well enough to warrant a sequel with the same controls. However, by the time the 3DS came around, Nintendo downsized the touchscreen implementations in some of their core games to a much more sensible degree. Ocarina of Time 3D keeps many key actions like movement, interacting, sword swinging, and targeting to their dedicated button. But due to the 3DS having fewer buttons than the N64 controller, the touchscreen is brought out to assist with the item button situation. Specifically, the top right and bottom right corners act as their own item buttons alongside X and Y, while the Ocarina is on the bottom left and Navi is on the top left. Although they don't feel as good to press as tactile buttons, I still appreciate the extra item slots and use them regularly, even on a 2DS where the buttons are higher up relative to the touchscreen, thus making these harder to press. Majora's Mask 3D keeps this layout in addition to adding support for the second circle pad found on the Circle Pad Pro and new 3DS. Both of these additionally come with ZL and ZR buttons, and I feel Nintendo missed a glaring opportunity to assign these to the two touchscreen item buttons. Over on the Wii U, the Wind Waker HD and Twilight Princess HD utilize the Wii U gamepad's touchscreen to allow for real-time map viewing and item switching without the need to pause the game. Sadly, your resident item button enthusiast cannot evaluate this due to never owning a Wii U, and in the case that these games were to be ported to Switch, this functionality would have to be removed due to the lack of a second screen. Nintendo's hardware has a lot of unique functions like that that future pieces of hardware lack, and this can cause issues when porting games from old platforms to new platforms. For example, the Japanese version of Zelda 1 lets the player defeat Paul's voices by shouting into the microphone on the second Famicom controller. Re-releases of this game, if they haven't managed to retain the microphone functionality, have tried all sorts of alternatives, including pressing and holding select, pressing select 4 times, rotating the C-stick, and simultaneously pressing L and ZL, or R and ZR. Of all the ways to play Famicom games, the Nintendo Classic Mini Famicom does not have a working microphone on its second controller, but does not have any alternative method to simulate it either, meaning Paul's voices must be defeated the hard way. Meanwhile, all international versions of the game give the Paul's voice a weakness to arrows. The layout of the N64 controller does not resemble that of any controller released since. While this was fine in the short term for N64 games designed around the controller, it makes them a bit harder to port to newer consoles with controllers not designed for them. Thus, ports usually have their controls reassigned on a game-by-game basis. The GameCube versions of Ocarina of Time and Majora's Mask backport the controls from the Wind Waker, and they work perfectly enough that they were kept for the Wii and Wii U Virtual Console releases. In addition, the latter adds full control remapping, a killer feature for any N64 game re-release, coming just in time for N64 and Nintendo Switch Online to throw it all out the window. The Wii and Wii U Virtual Console had unique controller mappings for each N64 game, whereas Switch Online attempted to create one universal layout that works for every N64 game, only for it to not fit a single one. Z is on ZL, but R is on R when it should have been on ZR, so that the target and shield buttons occupy the same pair of shoulder buttons like every previous release of the N64 Zelda game. Instead, L acts as L, and ZR is a shift that makes the four face buttons act as the C buttons. This is needlessly complicated, and I avoid using it whenever possible. And it's a pretty big issue if I'm feeling the need to avoid pressing the big ZR trigger meant for important actions. When not holding ZR, Y and X act as C left and C down respectively, when in previous releases X was instead C right. Here, C-right doesn't have a single button assigned to it. You have to use either an analog stick direction or a button combination. I need that item button to be conveniently available. This isn't something that the Switch's universal controller remapping can fix either. That simply rearranges the buttons on the controller, and the issue here is that the button isn't on the controller. Nintendo dropped the ball so hard with N64 Switch Online. When I'm playing a game on there, it feels like I'm fighting against the controls, because they don't do what I've known them to do in past releases of these games. Well, if collections with universal control bindings don't work out, surely individual remasters can do better. Skyward Sword HD faces the challenge of porting the most motion control heavy game in the series to a system that can be played as a handheld or with a traditional controller, inherently limiting the motion possible while holding them. Thankfully, the two Joy-Con can still be held in each hand like a Wii Remote and Nunchuck, but for alternative controller setups, the sword can also be swung using the right analog stick. I've heard mixed opinions on whether this is a sufficient replacement for the original controls, and I... have never played Skyward Sword HD, so I can't give an informed opinion on this matter. For all the flaws in these control schemes, what they demonstrate is a willingness for the Zelda series to experiment. When trying something new for the first time, it's inevitable that some things will go wrong, because you can't be perfect at anything right from the beginning. What you must do is evaluate what went well and what didn't, and next time iterate on what didn't go well until it does. We have seen that happen multiple times with the Zelda series. I believe its persistence at this cycle is a large reason why it's stuck around as one of Nintendo's flagship franchises, and why it's so consistently good after all these games. That said, why doesn't Twilight Princess HD support the Wii remote? I get why the Wii version may have excluded GameCube controller support because it was a Wii launch title and they wanted to demonstrate the Wii remote, but the HD version released on a 4-year-old dying console that natively supports the Wii remote. As a result, this version can't truly be called the definitive version of the game. Thank you for enjoying my rant about the history of controls in The Legend of Zelda. Join me next time for a deep dive into the reset button. Remember to subscribe so you don't miss it.